criticism you might make of Weird Science is that it is just such an over-the-top movie. And yet it's kind of a hard criticism to make stick because the movie knows it's over-the-top. It practically stands up and beats its chest and says, I'm over-the-top, I make no sense, and why not? Let's just have a good time.
You forget how fantastic that movie is in the true sense of the word, like fantastic as in fantasy.
So, what would you little maniacs like to do first?
It was the beginning of a whole new world of people with computers, and a computer was a magic word.
It's working, it's doing itself, it's working by itself.
But in terms of his overall career for Hughes, it did seem a little bit strange. The science fiction conceit is, you know, makes it a little bit different.
It's almost like it's plugged into the psyche of a teenage boy, and I thought it was the perfect kind of science fiction, and it just seemed to keep unfolding.
Get to work.
We were doing Breakfast Club, and the way this happened was one day, literally, John walked up to me in between takes in that high school we were filming in, and he goes, I got the next movie. I go, what? I'm like, this guy just put me in two movies, like already altered my life forevermore. He goes, it's gonna be you and another guy. And I was working on it last night, I did 30 pages. I'm like, what, dude? We shot all day yesterday. He went home and wrote 30 pages of this new script. I don't know where the inspiration came from. It was probably the least serious of maybe any of the films he's ever produced. But that's also fun. It was also, it was a comic book, it was a cartoon.
Anomaly is the word I would use to describe Weird Science.
It's very much of its time. You know, there was that whole fascination with how far can technology take us, you know, in the 80s. And, Kelly LeBrock was hot as hell. And, Anthony Michael Hall had become this household name. It seemed like a good idea in theory, and it is an entertaining film, but it does feel like it stands apart from the rest of the John Hughes canon.
Why? What's going on?
I don't know!
I thought that Weird Science was, of the three, the one that was the bigger head scratch to me. I thought that he was going to do more of a sort of Breakfast Club type movie after, and for him to go into that film was fine. It was just an odd choice.
Weird Science is a little bit different in the sense that it has this, you know, science fiction element to it, which makes it a little bit stranger than the other ones, because the other ones had been trying to be based in the real lives of teenagers, and suddenly you have this one that's a little bit more extreme, and that it kind of takes a lot of the same themes, but acts them out in this science fiction scenario. So I think it's a little bit of a departure in that sense.
Exactly. Then there's Weird Science. This was John's foray into fashion and excitement and titillation and sex.
It probably had the biggest budget John Hughes had at that point, because it has all these special effects. And it involves, you know, a woman stepping out of a computer and a missile coming up through the house and, you know, the brother being turned into this pile of crap.
Hi, dudes!
Sometimes when you're doing one kind of a project, sometimes you get, like, tired of a certain kind of feel. And so it makes sense that after doing something like Breakfast Club, to like, let's make a beautiful girl with our computer and have her slap everybody that bothers us around, you know?
Don't fret me, Al. You're out of shape. I'll kick your ass.
I remember when I saw Weird Science, the night it opened, middle of the 80s, this crazy over-the-top movie, but it totally made sense to me in terms of where John Hughes was at and that he'd made these two really, really good defining teen movies, and they were very soulful. And then he just said, all right, enough of that. I'm just gonna make a movie where my id takes over. And I sort of appreciated that. You gotta let it out. And he did.
And it's a whole lot better than it got credit for. You know, it's about overcoming who you are and needing something like a woman to step out of a computer and sort of show you how to live life.
Some of it is memorable. Like, you'd be surprised how many people still talk about the sort of classic image of the two guys with the bras on their heads. Yeah, it's juvenile, but it was memorable.
By the way, why are we wearing bras on our heads?
Ceremonial.
When that movie came out, the whole idea of having home computers and kids that work with computers was really a novelty.
And at that time, nobody had computers. John Hughes, with this computer, suddenly takes it and makes it the like main character of the movie in that it's the way to get the girl. You could use your computer and put in Time Magazine and get bombs and Einstein and tits and make what you want.
Perfect.
There's one aspect of Weird Science that's kind of brilliant ahead of its time, which is that the whole premise of the movie, where they're trying to create this perfect woman out of a computer and to specifications. This is really an internet era fantasy. Everyone's looking for the perfect porn site for them. And that's what these guys were doing. So it really anticipates the internet and the way that it would be used.
I remember being kind of disappointed that it wasn't just like softcore porn, you know, where she just shows up and is, you know, an object for them to entertain themselves with. It was like, oh, there's a lesson in this, you know?
I don't know. She said we're going to go downtown and, oh my God, whose stuff is this? Is that your slip? Wait, is this yours?
Oh, shit.
Why, what's going on here?
I don't know.
What is going on
Gary,
here?
I don't know.
I don't know
Gary,
what's going on here.
You look good though, all right?
Yeah?
Here you see the 80s really taking hold in fashion. You see, like, you know, ponytails on the sides of heads, and you see weird mullety perm things on the bad guys, you know, Robert Downey Jr. and his friend.
John Hughes had this incredible closeness to these characters that he was looking at the way they dressed, the way they talked, and sort of trying to decode all of this, and that he understood these codes of this new generation.
He had a vision for that, and he also had the idea for that haircut I had. I don't know where the hell that came from. He saw some dude in a magazine, he's like, how about that haircut? I was like, well, you're paying me, I guess I gotta get my haircut. I don't know what that was. I still don't know what that was. Page boy? I don't know what the hell that is.
That was the amazing thing about John's writing. I've done like 60 motion pictures as a designer, and I don't think I've come across scripts except his that are so revealing as to who these characters are.
I don't know how a man in his 30s knows enough to make kids look different than they looked in 16 Candles, which was only released a year earlier, but things had tipped, things had changed. Plus, it also had good music.
The main musical artist in Weird Science, Oingo Boingo, was sort of on the fringes of the new wave scene at that particular point and kind of had this science fiction-y, bizarro quality.
You sort of remember that title song from Weird Science. It stuck in my head all these years. And, you know, it was an early Danny Elfman credit, or Danny Elfman credit for the movies, and in a sense it helped segue him into becoming the movie composer that he is now.
In fact, when I hear She Blinded Me with Science, I think about Weird Science, even though it was not affiliated with that movie. So, yeah.
We'd be watching Road Warrior on the weekend, like a film like Road Warrior, and John would be like, yeah, we're gonna get that guy. And then all of a sudden that guy was in the scene at the end. We got the actual guy from Road Warrior, the Mel Gibson movie. I was like, this is amazing. And Robert Russler, and I met Downey at that point, and he was off and running. We went back to LA, we started prepping Weird Science, and the discussion came up. I guess John knew I would be one of the kids, and he was looking for the other kid. We saw him in a Universal film. It was a Universal film around that time. He had a good role in it, and we just thought that would be the guy. I don't know why. I just remember John, like, he just showed me tape on the scene, and when he spoke, all due respect, and you got a funny, where you had a funny voice. He just had this, like, baby little voice. Something about his voice.
My parents are coming home. Jess coming home. They're gonna freak out.
Years later, I had heard from certain people that he was teaching now and all that. It's just cool.
Drink.
Drink it.
Weird Science was the first time that I had been in Los Angeles to work in a movie. And we did that whole sequence in the bar where everybody freezes and we look at the door. And by the way, I was able to use the word malacca, which is a Greek term for jagoff. I guess the Chicago term, if we can use that. And all my Greek friends and family were, some of them were very disturbed, but others were happy that I brought it into modern American usage.
Tell me something. What's a beautiful broad like you doing with a malacca like this, huh?
It's purely sexual.
She's into malacca.
Capolos is back, you know, like we're with these other actors. Fats is in the house. And so that whole scene is kind of ad-lib. We just kind of ad-libbed it all. We had a couple of the lines worked out, how I had been embarrassed and how the girl in eighth grade kneed me in the nuts and all that other stuff. And then the rest of it, we just ad-libbed.
No. She did what? Bitch, need your nuts?
Bitch, need my nuts, man. Yeah, I'm not playing like with you. Jesus, man.
In the family jewels?
Oh, here he goes.
That was a blast. Yeah, there were so many reasons at that film. We just had such a good time, you know. And we got to look at Kelly Brock every day.
Hello? You guys have better loosen up.
And then we got Kelly LeBrock, who then became the It Girl, which was wonderful because it was easier to work with her. She really got it and carried out that whole John Hughes feeling of what he thought the most beautiful hot chick would be. This was John's interpretation.
Kelly showed up on the set on Weird Science, and I mean, it's like one of those Seabreeze commercials, like everybody was like, it was just like, she's so beautiful, you know? She's this sort of like angel that kind of falls in on us and shows us to how to be ourselves in a way. I know that the sort of morale of that is interesting.
And why don't we try and relax a little bit? I'm only kissing you.
These two kind of hopeless, hapless teenagers, and she kind of shows up to help set us straight in a way.
I can be a real serious bitch if I don't get what I want.
Ooh, hit me with your best shot.
Bill Paxton in Weird Science, which is, I told Bill this, I still think that his performance as Chet is one of the best performances by anybody at that time, and one of the most amusing performances by him.
He's just a great guy, a good old boy, man. He was really like a big brother, man. I love the guy. The scene at the end where he comes in and I'm with Suzanne Snyder in bed, even though we had like the dummy like rubber rifle, because of course when it was time for my close-up, I'm like wincing, waiting for it to come, and I was like anticipating it. So he was like, hit me on the head, and I just remember I was laughing our asses off when we were in that room, and he just hit me in the head.
You're dead meat, Pilgrim. I'll be back.
I have so many associations with Bill Paxton because he's had so many great parts, but I still always think of Chet when I see him. So that says something about the movie.
You're stewed, buttwad. Time to pay the fiddler.
He's that horrific older brother. You know, everybody's nightmare of an older brother. And I just think that there's an artfulness to that. Bill can play such a prick so marvelously.
Hey, what are big brothers for? See you upstairs.
Oh, God, I remember seeing Aliens for the first time and saying, hey, that's Bill Paxton. He was so funny in Weird Science, you know, doing the same kind of thing. Because he had the crew cut, and, you know, and the military attitude.
And you're like, oh my God, Chet's in Aliens. He's military, he's camo, and he gets killed. And you're not sad.
I never knew for sure, but I always thought that Anthony Michael Hall was sort of John Hughes' self-portrait, because you know, the humorist usually feels that they're a geek on some level. The great thing here in all three of these films is that he puts in layered performances, and they are different. The guy he plays in Breakfast Club is entirely different from the guy he plays in 16 Candles. And, you know, Weird Science is a totally different world.
In Weird Science, it's sort of a return to the 16 Candles kid. And that really could be an extension of the Farmer Ted character, except that he has changed in some really important ways. He learns truly about himself in a way that Farmer Ted wasn't going to in 16 Candles.
I'm gonna give you a choice.
Yeah, you can leave in peace.
Or you can stay and die.
But when you get down to it, John Hughes was trying to tell us something about the geek in each one, and kept going to the same actor, who was always great in those parts. It's too bad that the magic had to end with them, you know, that John Hughes didn't go on making movies about whatever kind of person Anthony Michael Hall could be.
I regret the fact that John isn't making films and doing stuff, well, if only for my career. But I think that he has a voice. Whether that voice is petered out, maybe he's done his work.
I think, you know, for John, that the business of the business was something that he wasn't a huge fan of. You know, I think for John, it was really more about the process and working with people. And maybe that was what directing was for John. Maybe it was just a piece of him that he wanted to experiment with and got that out of his system and was comfortable doing what he's doing.
I think he just needs a lot of freedom to do his own thing. And well, listen, I totally relate to this. He couldn't stand the machine that was Hollywood. He had to find another way to do it. That's what I think.
And I think he got what he needed to get out of Hollywood, and indeed, Hollywood got what they needed to get out of John. And maybe he saw the writing on the wall and split. I regret that John's not making movies now. I wish he was directing. And if he sees this, I hope that he does.
We saw sort of a second wave of teen movies, but they were very poppy, very superficial, shiny, pretty, and they didn't really have that substance or that sense of rich reality that the 80s teen movies did. And now I think maybe you're seeing a swing back toward the sincere, and those movies are finding a new audience.
John Hughes was all about making new kind of teen films for a new generation. And I don't think we've seen that. I think we've seen too many filmmakers stuck in the tropes that he invented. We haven't seen really the next John Hughes, and that would be probably the best way to pay him tribute, is if a filmmaker really could come out and tap what's going on in this generation.
No, I don't really know what happened either, but maybe he'll be back again someday, like Frosty the Snowman.
Oh my God!